tomahawk to the forehead.
What's the referee going to do? He tomahawked him right in the face, could have been right in the eye. The referee should disqualify him, but I think. I think Wahoo's already been exceeding the rules ridiculous.
Another chop in the throat. Covers his opponent. Oh, it looked like he hit.
It's that time again. Time for Pro Wrestling This Week. Hello, everyone. I'm Joe Pettisino.
And I'm Gordon Solie. During the program this week, we're going to see an AWA title match. We just saw the AWA champion Curt Hennig in action. Our map classic goes back to 1985 with Japanese women. Also, our sound-off feature this week with Boni Blackstone. Our international match will take place in Calgary, Canada. That and much, much more upcoming during this program. And Joe, of course, our first stop is Texas.
We're going to World Class Championship Wrestling, where a new person has made the scene. It's the world-famous Iron Sheik, and he is making his appearance known in the World Class area. Let's take a look at one of his first matches in World Class, this one against Salvador Oliveres.
That was the welcoming of Ali Mazzari, the Iron Sheik, Iranian national anthem and all. Bronco Limit, your referee, Sal Oliveres, his opponent, Gary Hart, the manager. Well, Kerry Von Erich certainly looked great as he cleared the ring in our previous bout, and I'm joined now by a good friend of the Von Erichs and KEGL personality. We mentioned that in our previous bout, John Roberts.
Mark, it's always great to be here, and you're right. That's the most agility I've seen Kerry show in the ring in many, many months. Won't be long now.
The Iron Sheik, world-renowned former heavyweight champion of the World Wrestling Federation, now emerging with world class. In his first spot with Sal Oliveres in the corner, the Iron Sheik pounds ahead into that pointed.
Talk about a great international star. This man's been an Olympic champion for Iran. One of the most widely publicized professional wrestlers for, say, maybe what, the last 10, 15 years?
Side Soto.
Over and down, he takes out Oliveres. Certainly respected, but not popular.
That's true.
Okay. Punish him. I punish him now.
One, two, by referee Lubitsch, and it appeared to me, John, that the Sheik pulled him up. Might have been able to pin him.
I think he wants to show us what he's made of, and if I've never seen the Iron Sheik before, you're in for a treat. He is the consummate wrestler. His tactics may not be the most popular in the house, as you mentioned, Mark, but oh, it looks like he's getting set up for that camel clutch.
Trademark move of the Iron Sheik from behind on Sal Oliveres. Submission City here is certainly a possibility.
The back pain with the pressure that this puts on the lower back, this is what the Sheik won the world championship with. I think he just wants to rub his nose in the face that he feels that the American wrestlers can't measure up. What's he doing?
Covering him up as if though he were a corpse or something with the Iranian flag. Let's go to Ralph Pulley.
Pro Wrestling This Week continuing now, and Gordon, it's time to go to Central States.
And Kansas City is indeed our next stop. We're going to be watching a newcomer, Steve Ray, going up against a more experienced Steve Estes, but watch out for this power slam.
About this ever dance, where the bell sounds, Steve Estes down from behind, a sneak attack on Steve Ray. Pounding Steve into that far turnbuckle. Steve Ray never even got a chance to see what hit him from behind. Steve Estes caught him. Again, Ray slammed into the far turnbuckle. Estes is all over him. And Bob Geigel, things are looking dark for Steve Ray.
Well, I tell you, the kid's a big, impressive, strong guy. Sonny Myers is his trainer, and he's awful high on him. I wouldn't count him down yet.
Steve Estes giving it everything he's got. Steve Ray, a little bit dazed, doesn't look any the worse for wear, though.
He's a big, strong-looking kid, isn't he?
I imagine so. Both men now tying up collar and elbow. Pulling each other around in the ropes. The referee's going to call for a break here. Little cheap shot from Estes.
Cheap shot, but listen, he might have to pay for those. If I was Estes, I'd keep an eye on this kid.
Both men bulling around in the ring. Estes slamming his man into the corner. Goes, catches Steve Ray. Ray catches him with a throw.
Look at that. Hey, that Ray came up from the bottom on that one, didn't he?
Steve Ray now setting Steve Estes, throwing his man into the ropes, catches him with a power slam. What a move!
What a devastator.
The winner of the match is Steve Ray.
Well, certainly I think young Steve Ray has a bright future in front of him. You know, Joe, the other day I was up in New York visiting with Stan Weston, the publisher of Pro Wrestling Illustrated, and it was nice to visit with all of the folks there.
Isn't that a wonderful office?
Sure is.
Now that we've said nice things about him, it's time for our PWI report, and I'm going to say for one of the few times I don't agree with Bill Apter.
Well, everyone's entitled to their opinion.
Well, you're about to hear Bill Apter's opinion. First, he's going to give you the top 10 wrestlers in the Continental area, and then the most popular 10 wrestlers in America. Then he has his opinion on Humperdink, Bigelow, and Orndorff.
Today, ratings for the Continental Wrestling Association and also the most popular ratings. Right now, let's take a look at Continental rankings. And now the top 10 on PWI's most popular list. You just saw our most popular ratings. Now, speaking about most popular, Sir Oliver Humperdink, Paul, Mr. Wonderful Orndorff, Bam Bam Bigelow, three men, two wrestlers managed by Sir Oliver Humperdink in the WWF, and you fans are cheering them. I don't want to say this, but are you crazy? Sir Oliver Humperdink is one of the most notorious managers in the history of wrestling. He had the House of Humperdink. He's managed so many rule breakers, I've lost count. And now, all of a sudden, Paul Orndorff, Mr. Wonderful, once again says, I want to be a fan favorite, and here's my new manager, Sir Oliver Humperdink. Two rule breakers here for the price of one. Then Humperdink says he's the manager of Bam Bam Bigelow, the nicest guy and best wrestler in the world. Bam Bam Bigelow, a nice guy? Do you remember this guy's past? I mean, he's one of the biggest, and I don't just mean weight, rule breakers in the entire wrestling industry. Let me tell you something, fans. Before you start cheering for these three, take a good look in our magazines at their past and then decide whether you should cheer them or boo them. For Pro Wrestling Illustrated magazine, I'm senior editor Bill Apter. Now back to Joe and Gordon.
Well, as we said, interesting editorial comments from Bill Apter of PWI Magazine. More next week right here on Pro Wrestling This Week. Right now, it's time for the WWA, the Women's Wrestling Association, the ladies of POWW. And we're going to go take a look at Wendy Richter now as she takes on Peggy Lee Leather.
Don't tell yourself out too much. You are mine.
Terrace and Jeannie Beret heading back to the locker room, fans. It's pandemonium and bedlam. Wendy Richter in there jamming Peggy Lee's head into the top turnbuckle. Wendy Richter, who claimed to fame, was in WrestleMania 1 with none other than Rockstar manager Cyndi Lauper, has picked up the big 220-pound Peggy Lee and is jamming on the midsection. Bill Holden is counting, and Peggy Lee is ignoring the count. She's just continuing the brutal assault on Peggy Lee Leather. It was the terrorist, the Syrian terrorist, Pali Elizar, and Peggy Lee together that combined their efforts to take Wendy Richter and put her back on the mat for a few moments, I might add. Oh, she's trying to snap that leg of Peggy Lee. Wendy Richter, who has all the skills as well as the physical ability to be a world-class champion that she is. And I'm so happy and proud that she is now fighting for the WWA, Women's Wrestling Association, and the POWW, Powerful Women of Wrestling League. This is where you see the best action across the country and across the world. Right here, fans, every week, POWW. Wendy Richter delivering the big boot into the shoulder blades of Peggy Lee Leather. Jamming the shoulder now into the midsection of Peggy Lee. Wendy Richter is continuing her assault. Reversal. Peggy Lee climbs the second ropes. Oh, she snapped back because Wendy Richter, smartly, like the ring veteran she is, holds onto the rope.
With a neck breaker. That might do it. Going for pin. One, two.
More action now on Pro Wrestling This Week, and we're going to the World Wrestling Federation, where a new team was formed this week. They call themselves the Mega Powers. Hulk Hogan and Macho Man Randy Savage. And how did that come about? The whole world watched last weekend as Randy Savage took on the Honky Tonk Man. Interestingly enough, a lot of the action was set up beforehand with a conversation between Jimmy Hart and Elizabeth. Let's take a look at that conversation now with Craig DeGeorge.
Right, Jimmy Hart says he's not too concerned. Elizabeth, are you concerned about the matchup?
Well, of course I'm concerned. I want him to win, but most of all, I'm worried about his safety.
Well, let me tell you something, baby. You better be concerned over him, because I promise you this, we're going to humiliate the Macho Man. And before it's all over, we might play a little tune on him. You know what I mean, man?
I'll tell you something, Mouth of the South. You have had a lot to say on this subject.
Well, yes, Jimmy Hart has had a lot to say. And yes, the Honky Tonk Man has had a lot to say. But after this match is over, they both could be eating their words.
Some remarkable changes in Randy Savage due to Elizabeth.
I think so, Gordon. You know, she's had a profound effect on the Macho Man. And later in the night, the fans saw even more. She got up in the ring to ask the Honky Tonk Man and the Hart Foundation to not team up against Savage, as the Honky Tonk Man was about to hit Savage with his guitar. Unfortunately, the Honky Tonk Man, proving he was no gentleman, pushed and hit Miss Elizabeth. And of course, that was just too much. She went in the back, came back with Hulk Hogan, and between the two of them, they were able to chase off the Honky Tonk Man and the Hart Foundation. Now, we hope to have some exclusive interviews and some footage of that next week right here on Pro Wrestling This Week. But the Mega Powers in the WWF, a new team, Randy Savage and Hulk Hogan. That ought to be great. Right now, let's take a look at Paul Orndorff in action. He's going up against Dave Wagner, but look what happens in the background on this one.
I think Orndorff is concentrating on this match against Dave Wagner. He's doing a number on him. I think he's even noticed that Rick moves around.
I personally think Orndorff's embarrassed by Rick Rude.
I don't think so at all. I think Orndorff has done
an excellent job of paying attention to this matchup.
Absolutely. Ooh, wow. He's concentrating on the match and doing quite a number on Dave Wagner.
Go for the power drive. He has Wagner in position. Scoops him up and what's going to happen? What a cover. And a three count.
But does he want a piece of Rick Rude? I don't think so.
Here is your winner, Mr. Wonderful, Paul Orndorff.
Our next destination is Portland, Oregon, where we follow the continuing saga of Mike Miller. He's been having more than his share of problems of late with the Grappler and others. Well, Mike has decided it's time for a change of image and a time for a change of friendships. He has a new friend now called Lucille. You'll see it appear a little later on.
We're both out here, camera center, in front of your screen. Oh, he hit that post with his shoulder.
Yeah. That's the real good way to damage the post. There's the Grappler, right hand. Miller with a right hand. Grappler, right hand.
They're going at it.
Hey, win.
It's a Pier 9 brawl.
Oh, Grappler. Now, that's going to be a disqualification.
Boy, to get him out of there.
What, one more. Well, Miller sends him away.
Miller don't want any part of it.
We could have a double disqualification here. If these guys keep that up, out goes Miller again. Sandy, how would you like to be? How'd you like to be Sandy Barr?
Hey, my mama didn't raise any fools. I don't want any part of that ring.
No way.
I like it right up here. Enough space between me and them.
Oh, Miller's got Lucille. Yeah.
He got the 2x4. He affectionately, that thing's got nails in it.
Yeah, he does have nails. Now what?
Look out!
Oh! My word. You see, what's the matter with this guy? What's the matter with him? He doesn't have to do that. Look what he's doing.
Slapping that boot. I wonder what that boot must be loaded. I'll bet that thing's loaded.
Oh, right, he just got him right in the head.
He kicked him right square in the face. Miller's down. He's hurting. Here. Barr's got his legs tangled.
Yeah, we got to get somebody
get some
in here.
Get some help for that referee.
We need this bodyguard, Ray, to take care of the situation down there with Sandy. But Sandy
Miller's
hurt.
Been cut.
You bet he has been with that boot. And look at the Grappler. We need some help in here, Dutch. We got to get some help. Miller is bleeding from the forehead.
This Grappler's trying to cripple him. Oh, my goodness. Miller's cut wide open there. There's a knee.
I hope Grappler doesn't
Sandy
see that
Barr's
board
got
over
bad
there.
Ankle.
Oh, he did see the board. Now he's got the board. This is ridiculous. We definitely got to get some help in here for Mike Miller. Miller's hurting right now.
What's he going to do with that 2x4?
Here comes Bill Casey. Here comes Avalanche.
Here comes Coco.
Oh. Coco's in there, and Grappler is out.
While we're in the Pacific Northwest, let's move just a little bit further north now to Calgary, Canada, and our international match of the week. It's Ron Ritchie taking on Goldie Rogers, and the interesting thing is an explanation by Eddie Whalen on the penalty and disqualification system used in pro wrestling in Canada.
Escapes the pin. Jürgen Herman has just awarded a second yellow card to Goldie Rogers. The card system, one card, a warning, then you get another yellow card, second warning, a third one, a red card, automatic disqualification. Goldie Rogers on the brink of disqualification. And Ron Ritchie in all kinds of trouble. Getting those size 10s right across the throat. That's a choke. Jürgen Herman pulls Goldie Rogers off him. He did not like the looks of that chokehold. Here he goes, off the ropes. Whoa, both men. Just go flying, we'll see who can recover first. Oh, Richie. Goldie Rogers tried to slam him down. Big mistake. Wound up with Richie on top of him. Richie, your winner.
At the beginning of today's show, we showed you just a little bit of an AWA title match. Gordon, time now for that match.
We're going to watch Curt Hennig, the AWA World Heavyweight Champion and son of Larry the Axe Hennig, take on the legendary Wahoo McDaniel. Curt Hennig has said many, many times that he doesn't care how he wins a match as long as he wins. Watch what happens now.
He is as good yet as he will be.
Well, I mean, he's not as good as I am, but that takes years and years. It's about time, and Wahoo's been asking for his own medicine back. Kurt can play medicine man.
Curt Hennig with some shots to the solar plexus of Wahoo McDaniel. Wahoo winds up, cocks the arm for another one of those judo shots.
In fact, if you ask me, just from watching the tactics of McDaniel, I'll bet you any money that Wahoo's afraid of him. Wahoo's trying to take some shortcuts and cheap shots, and that only reflects to me that he realizes Curt Hennig is a better wrestler. He's afraid of him.
I'm afraid you'd lose money there on that bet, Larry Zbysko. And now it is Curt Hennig firing back. And Wahoo McDaniel answers in kind as they go at each other toe-to-toe. And a tomahawk to the forehead.
This is what he's going to do. He tomahawked him right in the face. Could have been right in the eye in reference to disqualifying, but I think.
I think Wahoo's already been exceeding the rules ridiculous.
They take the chop in the throat. Covers his opponent. Oh, it looked like he had it. And she thought he had it. 10 minutes has
gone by. We're at the 10-minute mark of this one fall, 1 hour time limit match for the heavyweight championship of the world. From the Showboat Sports Pavilion in Las Vegas, Nevada, I'm Rod Tronka, along with the living legend, Larry Zbysko, with the call of the action. And
well, a lot of people might be upset Curt Hennig stepped out of the ring. I do it myself. But why should I stay in the ring when the other guy is just breaking the rules?
There is a shot to the head.
It's about time. Hennig nailed him.
Fist.
Paul Wahoo did.
Totally illegal.
Was punch him and kick him and elbow.
Totally illegal. And here we go again.
And Hennig still managed to outmaneuver him, do beautiful wrestling moves.
And Wahoo McDaniel, I believe,
looks
is
like,
split
wide. You know what? It looks like Wahoo got it.
He got out. One, two, three, just like...
Well, as Gordon said, obviously Curt Hennig does not care how he wins those matches any longer, but if I were the AWA champ, I would be careful of an Indian on the warpath in the near future. Time now to go to Sound Off with Boni Blackstone, where you, the viewer, get to sound off. This week we've got a comment on foreign objects, and a fan has a question about my co-host, Gordon Solie.
I'm Boni Blackstone, and first let me thank the thousands of you who have written in with questions and comments. Now, down to business. Mike L. of Columbus, Georgia, who's watching WXTX Channel 54, has a question about one of our own. Gordon Solie is the best. Can you tell me how long he's been involved in wrestling and if he's won any awards? Gordon Solie, who has been called the Walter Cronkite of professional wrestling, is approaching his 28th year as one of America's top sports broadcasters. Gordon has received many awards in broadcasting honoring his skills. These include several Announcer of the Year awards, among those the one for 1987. And recently, he became the first wrestling personality to have a trivia game named after him. What lies ahead in Gordon's future? Well, in his own words, that remains to be seen. And in closing, these words of wisdom from Gerald L. of Birmingham, Alabama, watching WTTO, Channel 21. All foreign objects should be outlawed. The use of whips, brass knuckles, green spew, chains, handcuffs, and the like certainly detract the credibility of wrestling. Their use is just dumb. Come on, guys, clean up your act, and let's get back to wrestling. Our questions this week came from the guys. So, girls, I'm encouraging you to write to us here at Pro Wrestling This Week Sound Off. Post Office Box 54556, Atlanta, Georgia 30308. girls, and guys. Let me know your station's call letters. I'll see you next week, but right now, stay here for more great wrestling action.
Well, my thanks to all of you for your interest. Memphis, Tennessee is our next stop, and the Southern boys are reunited. We're going to watch Tracy Smothers now as he takes on Keith Eric in a single match. But as I said, the Southern boys are reunited.
In there, Dave. He caught him and just ripped him right across with that arm drag, popped him over and down with it.
Tracy rolls those shoulders down, count as two. That's all they got, just a two count. Two count again. Tracy wraps that arm up behind the back of Keith Eric.
Come on, how about it?
Down he goes, shoulders are down. Referee starts the count. Look out, Tony Blocker coming in. Well, it's going to be a disqualification on Keith Eric.
Armstrong, and everybody is familiar with the wrestling Armstrong family. Steve comes in to help out an old friend against Tanaka. And Paul Diamond.
Yeah, what?
Look out! Tracy Smothers with Paul Diamond. Tracy hammered into that ring post as Paul shook him off. Got him right in the shoulder. Referee Jerry Calhoun having no success in getting this thing slowed down. Tanaka over here on Steve Armstrong. Here comes Eddie Marlin. Randy Hales out.
All back in the ring now.
Diamond pounding the smother. Steve Armstrong whipped out of there. Reverse. Look at that. Smothers and Armstrong taking over now. Tracy just pulls Diamond down to the mat. Armstrong pounding on Tanaka. Jeff Jarrett, Billy Travis join the action, and I think if Diamond and Tanaka are smart, they will get out of here.
And another issue that I don't think will ever be resolved is the one with the danger zone and Paul E. Dangerously. Here's a man of egomaniacal proportions. Let's watch this interview with John Michaels.
This week on A Danger Zone, my guest is one-third of Bad Company in the AWA Georgia area, John Michaels. And John, I know you're as excited as I am, because right here on Pro Wrestling This Week, I'm going to let the whole world in on the biggest secret. Bill Apter! Ha ha, brother, you got one unbelievable bulk of mail coming your way. Because, John, I'm going to tell you, I am going to run this year for Rookie of the Year. That's right. The first time a manager has ever been in the running for Rookie of the Year. So readers of Pro Wrestling Illustrated, Inside Wrestling, The Wrestler, all those magazines out there, gear up. Because Paul E. Dangerously is going to do something that no other manager has ever done. Because a rookie is a man, John, in his first year of a profession, and I'm a rookie, so I'm a manager. I'm a rookie. And I want that Rookie of the Year award, John. And I know that you think I should be Rookie of the Year.
I agree with you. I don't think there's anybody that comes closer to you. I can promise you that.
Really?
Really, man.
Hey, man, I wasn't going to let you talk, man, but I kind of like you. Hey, tell them how good-looking you are, man. Go ahead.
Oh, man, look at it, baby.
Oh,
and look who I'm with, man.
Oh, I like him so much. You know what? You know what? We're going to go now, and we're going to go get some broads, and we'll see you next week, and I'm going to be Rookie of the Year. Oh, I like you, man. Oh, man, bro, Rookie of the Year. I'm going to call him right now. After. Oh, hello.
Well, as we see, it is certainly easy to make friends with Paul E. Dangerously. All you have to do is agree with him, as John Michaels found out. Let's move now to the NWA and the UWF for this week's Ring Report. We told you last week about a new world heavyweight champion in the NWA as Ronnie Garvin defeated Ric Flair. This week, the world tag team titles have changed hands. It happened in a small town in North Carolina this week. Before the match, the Midnight Express came out and attacked the Rock and Roll Express, injuring Ricky Morton. The match went on, though, as it was scheduled as a title defense against Arn Anderson and Tully Blanchard. They obviously took advantage of the fact that Morton was injured, and they did end up pinning the Rock and Roll Express and winning the titles, the new World Tag Team title champions, Arn Anderson and Tully Blanchard. Also, this week in the NWA, the first interview from Ric Flair since losing the title. He had some interesting words for Ronnie Garvin, including, "Watch your back." Interestingly enough, it wasn't him that he was talking about. He says Garvin has to be careful of the likes of Dusty Rhodes, Barry Windham, and the such, because they want that world heavyweight title too. And he reminds Garvin that when you're the champion, you have no friends. That's what's happening in the NWA this week. We'll have more in our ring report next week. We'll be back after we take a timeout. We're going to take a look at what's going on in Continental Championship Wrestling, and we've got a very interesting Mat Classic coming your way right after this.
Dumbo now the one on the receiving end of all this pain and punishment. Still listening. Dumbo straight up the end. Down onto a hit 170.
All heard that politics make strange bedfellows, and that holds in wrestling as well as in elections. The politics of Jonathan Boyd has led to a team of Tom Pritchard and Scott Armstrong. Let's take a look at these two now go up against one of Boyd's teams, the Moondogs.
Some help here. I wasn't doing it as much for him at the moment as I was for myself, just to show these guys and Jonathan Boyd what I'm made of.
Well, I think first and foremost, Tom, that we need to say this, because I'll never forget the night that you finally decided you'd head it with Lord Jonathan Boyd. And you said, first and foremost, I'm always an American, and I can't help but feel that this had to come to the fore once again.
Well, that's right. You know, John and Mike and I, we rode up and down the roads. We talked about the Armstrongs, and we talked about unity. We talked about staying together. John told us, he said, New Zealand is a country that can do it for you all the way. And, in fact, right here on the ring, or that night here in Birmingham, when I finally had enough, I said, John, I'm not listening to what you got to say anymore here. And I in Knoxville, it just happened to be the right time. In fact, I asked Scott to come out here today, and I said, Scott, I wish you'd just come to the podium right now and at least shake my hand, and at least I can't say I'm sorry all of a sudden and just come out here and say, gosh, everything I've done is wrong in my life. But sometimes you do make mistakes, and I have made a lot of mistakes in my life, and I can't expect everybody to trust me, and I can understand why maybe he wouldn't want to come out here today. But I did show in this match that I was on at least trying to get the job done. And you watch right here. Both of these Moondogs here, one of them had me, and John was holding me here. John had nothing but contempt for me, obviously. And if there's one thing worse than Scott Armstrong's super kick, it's a double super kick right there. And I think that Moondog laid out for a good 10, 15 minutes, Gordon.
Well, there's proof of the pudding in this, obviously, as the Moondog is down. And so, Tom Pritchard, wait a minute.
I know I'm not supposed to be here. You just wait a bloody minute. I'm back there listening to you and your Yankee bull, and that's exactly what it is, Pritchard. You didn't know nothing when you came to the Wild Bunch. You didn't know a thing, and now you know a bloody lot. And you, as far as I'm concerned, are nothing but a turncoat. And if you want somebody's hand, Pritchard, if you want somebody to come out here and give you their hand, I've extended my hand to you 1,000 times, but never like this.
Whoa, wait a minute.
And hey, if he has anything more to say about the Wild Bunch, you get him in the ring right now.
Oh, come on now. Well, Lord Jonathan, hey, wait a second. Dr. Tom Pritchard catching Sir Jonathan Boyd, or Lord Jonathan Boyd, Mr. Jonathan Boyd, whatever. Hold on. There's Mike Golden catching Pritchard from behind. Golden. Now, so, Pritchard battling two men, Boyd and, wait a second. Scott Armstrong just hit the seat. We've got to get order restored. We'll be back.
Well, February 7th is the target date, of course, for the Dream Cruise. It's going to take place February 7th through the 14th of February. 6 nights and 7 days.
And Joe, 56 meals.
Yeah, okay. I kind of figured you'd be on top of that one.
56 meals along with great wrestlers on the cruise. Wrestlers like Bruiser Brody, Jerry Lawler, Wendy Richter, the Missing Link. Red Bastien is going along with us, as is Ken Mantell, who, of course, is working with the UWF Training Center, and he tells us that he has some interesting things on the cruise from the Training Center. And I guess we should mention Paul E. Dangerously.
He's buying his own way.
He bought his own ticket. He is not officially part of the cruise, and we are not responsible for what Paul E. does on the cruise. We are responsible, though, for making sure that you have a great time. I'll be there along with Gordon Soley, Boni Blackstone, all from Pro Wrestling This Week. Craig Peters, Bill Apter from Pro Wrestling Illustrated will be there, and we are looking forward to having a great time with you. If you would like to go on the Wrestling Fans Dream Cruise, you should call the Great Escapes Travel at 714-592-5608. That's 714-592-5608. And Gordon, I think we should emphasize here, time is running short on signing up for the cruise. They have a payment plan so that you can pay it off in three payments, but time is running short. If you want to go, you need to call and get the information on the cruise today, Gordon.
And we're looking for all of you with the WFIA to be making your attendance as well.
That's right. Right, time right now to go to our Matt Classic. It's an interesting one this week, featuring the women, Gordon.
Japan is our location. 1985 is the year. Jumbo Hoy going up against Asuka. And this is Jumbo Hoy's last match.
Jumbo has her opponent in the corner with that foot to the throat. The ref is calling for a break, and Jumbo is not going to break. She's using the rope for leverage. These fans do not like to see Asuka in trouble. Yeah, they like to see that, though. They like to see that. When the tables turn and Asuka gets a better hand, driving her opponent to the mat, and now taking charge. Again with a drop kick as Asuka drops her opponent to the mat twice. Jumbo now the one on the receiving end of all this pain and punishment. Asuka with her Jumbo straight up to you. Down onto her head, 170 pounds on the top of your head. Count of two again before Jumbo bridges up. These girls are tired, both of them now, slow to get up, both of them trying to end this match. She's not going to end it like that. Down on her back goes Asuka. And now it looks like Jumbo is going for a figure four. Nope, she's applying, that's the Scorpion's death lock. And Asuka is in pain, look at her face. Jumbo realizes now that this match can be almost given away. Jumbo now with that Scorpion death lock. Where's the referee? Look at that lady in pain now. The referee is over on the side talking to somebody. Referee's asking Asuka, Asuka, you want to give this up? Asuka says no. Meanwhile, Jumbo continues to apply the pressure. What's this? Yeah, look to me like Asuka baited her opponent. Jumbo said, go ahead and jump. Go ahead and jump. And now Asuka and Jumbo both on the top of the turnbuckle there in the corner of the ring, both off onto their back. Crossbody back. Oh! I don't think the fans were too pleased with that. The ref was a little hesitant in his call. Asuka now helping Jumbo to her feet by use of her hair. And puts Jumbo to her back. Now the tables turn. As once again the Scorpion Deathlock is applied, but this time it's applied to Jumbo. Jumbo Hoy on her face now as she is in pain and realizing now what just moments ago Asuka was going through. And that's it. That's it. Jumbo Hoy concedes the match to Asuka, who applied the...
risk. Gordon Solie's Championship Wrestling Trivia Game.
Now, let's go back to this Championship Wrestling Trivia Game already in progress.
Okay. 3, 1, 2, 3. Blue, true or false?
Okay, true or false. Clenched fist is technically illegal in pro wrestling.
Oh, that's easy!
Come on, Dad.
False, I think.
No, Dad, that's true. I've drawn on my 30 years in the sport of pro wrestling to develop this wrestling trivia game for fans of all ages.
Yes, the Dean of TV Wrestling Commentators, Gordon Solie, brings you this exclusive television offer. Call 1-800-645-1000 with your MasterCard or Visa, or mail $29.95 plus $4 shipping and handling to Wrestling Trivia Game, P.O. Box 23426, Tampa, Florida, 33623. Be sure to order today. That's 1-800-645-1000. Get yours now. Not available in stores. Bonus to the first 1,000 orders, a free sound sheet from Gordon Solie with a personal message.
Closing moments here on PWTW. It's time to name our wrestler of the week, and the board came up with an unusual decision.
Gordon, I wish we had the music Stand By Your Man for this week's wrestler of the week. It's Elizabeth. The board decided that that's exactly what she had done because of her stand by Randy Savage, not only as his manager, but getting in the ring, trying to help, and then bringing Hulk Hogan into the fray as well. Let's go back and take a look at the wit and beauty of Miss Elizabeth.
Well, yes, Jimmy Hart has had a lot to say, and yes, the Honky Tonk Man has had a lot to say. But after this match is over, they both could be eating their words.
Well, our congratulations to Elizabeth as our Wrestler of the Week, abbreviated. That's WOW, and when I look at her, WOW.
That's exactly what you think, isn't it?
Amen. We'd like to welcome a new station aboard with us, too, now, from Seattle, KSTW, Washington. Certainly welcome aboard, and until next week, I'm Gordon Solie.
I'm Joe Petticino. We'll see you right back here for another edition of What's Happening in the World of Wrestling on Pro Wrestling This Week. See you next week.